Last year, flooding cost the global economy more than $82 billion. And flood accounted for 31% of the global economic losses from natural catastrophes, according to Swiss Re. By 2030, urban property worth more than $700 billion will be impacted annually by coastal and riverline flooding. Climate change has become a catalyst driving floating architecture towards the mainstream. And over the last two decades, Water Studio has designed more than 300 floating homes, offices, schools and healthcare centers around the world. And now they are developing a fully functioning floating city in the Maldives. Koen Oldhuis is the founder of Water Studio. He was chosen on Time magazine's list of most influential people in the world. French magazine Terra Eco chose him as one of the 100 green persons that will change the world. A big hand for Koen Oldhuis.
We started 20 years ago designing floating houses, and in the next 20 minutes I want you to show a little bit what we do beyond the waterfront. I wanted to start with a picture of my grandfather. My grandfather, his family name was Boat. He was a boat builder. And he loved to sail. But of course, in the 50s, there was still a lot of ice in the winters. So it was not possible to start sailing. So he came up with this thing, what we call an UFO, an unidentified floating object. Because it had a wing, but it's not a plane. It had a hull, but it's not a boat. It had sliders, but it's not a sled. So it was something that was new and unidentified. And he could go over the ice with more than 120 kilometers an hour. And what I learned from him, that as situations change, you can take that as an opportunity, and you can bring that in your advantage. So when we started to design structures on water, and we wanted to pave the waves for floating cities, we also had to go through a lot of innovations and a lot of steps. One of the first steps we had to do is we had to make sure that these floating houses, which we already have seen for 100 years in the Netherlands, were no longer boats. We had to make them houses. So for that, we had to build them under the building code. But of course, if you do that, they become much more expensive, and they also become more heavy, and there was a lot of things we had to change. But in the end, we managed to make a whole floating neighborhood here in Amsterdam, like 15 minutes from here, with houses, floating homes that for the first time were seen as houses. But of course, floating homes is not only for the rich, you also have to make sure that they are a little bit more affordable. So we started to build houses, two on one floating platform, semi-detached. We had to do a step because of the need for sustainability. So we made some houses in a floating neighborhood together with other architects, which is the most sustainable neighborhood in Europe, with the solar, with the whole sewage, intelligent sewage system. So it's every time we had to bring new innovations to the job. And always it's also about bending the rules, because if you start to build on water, authorities don't give you that much freedom. Here we were allowed to build 2.5 layers, but nobody told me where that half layer should be in the building. So instead of having the half layer on top, we put the half layer in the middle. And now we can easily, with glass putting around it, make still a very large building. So it's a bit playing with what's possible. This is also a floating building, but this is an amphibious floating building. So it looks like a normal building, but it allows you, if you look rock around the house, you will see the other side, that it is still in the water. And if the water will rise in this flood area, then the whole house will come up and will go down. So all steps needed to provide urban components to be ready to build cities. Not only in canals, but also in rivers. This is in Dordrecht, and the river that can rise easily 4 to 5 meters. And of course, if you're on a holiday and you come back, you will still find your house on the same spot, maybe a little bit higher. And we guide them with these kind of guiding piles next to it. So through the years, through these kind of 20 years of experience, we constantly try to push the limits and try to bring a little bit of innovation and make all these buildings ready for next steps, for larger buildings and for a floating city. So also going from a very simple concrete foundation to large foundations with undefined shapes. Shapes that make it ready for us to build, for instance, floating islands. The islands you can move, so they are, you can build them in a ship wharf and you can tow them over the water and to remote locations. So also there we push the limit from a house towards a complete island. If you can build islands, you also can build floating apartment buildings with higher density. And these higher densities, they are necessary because with these floating apartments, you also can connect them to each other. And by that, you can even create whole floating neighborhoods. And the beauty about floating neighborhoods with apartment buildings is that you don't have to dig your canals. By just bringing those platforms close to each other, you can create immediately these canals in between. So in Amsterdam, we have to dig the canals and we have to maintain them, but here they just exist because of these floating platforms close to each other. Okay, so we have our components, 20 years of experience, and now we have to go to the next step, because we think that floating buildings can be a kind of medicine for to cure our cities. And we have to cure them, because our cities are sick. If you see a normal city in a normal project, then it's absolutely difficult for an architect or an urban planner to make a plan, because you don't know what the future will bring. There's political change, technical change, environmental change, and every plan that I will make today will be outdated in 4 or 5 years when it's ready. So you have to bring flexibility, adaptability. In fact, you have to make a city that looks like a chameleon, that instantly can change and that can adjust, and that there's a very short response time. If you have a change, then within 2 or 3 months, your city should change too. So that means that my role is not longer an architect, but I'm much more like a DJ. And we behind knots, we start to tune the city a bit, and we can create flexibility by playing with these parameters. And these parameters are, for instance, flexibility. The beauty of the flexibility on water is that it's easy to reconfigure. I had this client in Lebanon, and he said, Koen, I want to have a fantastic floating villa, but I want, in the summer, it must be a very open building. I want to see over the water. I want to park my boat against my house. But in the winter time, I want it to be much more compact, and I just don't want to see everything. And I want to be, it has to be much more warmer. So we designed the house from 3 parts, which within 2 hours' time, we could disassemble it, reconnect it, and change it to this building. So exactly the same building, the same elements. And that's the beauty about water. But if you take that one step further, you also can do that with floating parks. This is a project for Toronto, where they want to have a seasonal park. As you know, the seasons in Toronto, in winter very cold, summer very hot. So in the summer, it should be a park that's open, and you can go with your boats in between, and there's a lot of space. And in the winter, then within a few days, they can reconfigure it, and it accesses this kind of platforms that take wind away, and we can walk on these platforms. If you really want to make floating cities work, it's not about the single houses, it's not about the apartments, but we really have to start growing up. We have to go to vertical buildings. And for that also, there was a lot of things we had to change. So this is a building we designed for Miami. Miami, fantastic, but this is a city which is threatened by sea level enormously. There is no way you can make dikes or levees around it, and there are hurricanes that threaten the city there. So we designed this floating villa, and we had the technology from the Netherlands, which we pushed over. So if it's normally on the water, it's a platform, but if you push a button, you can also use it as a ship, completely practical. You can move it anywhere you want. And then when there is a storm, you push another button, and then the whole building lifts itself up 6 meters out of the water, 18 feet. By that, the wind can and the waves can't hit the building anymore, because it's only with 4 stilts in the water, and it can resist a hurricane 4. Of course, a very expensive building won't help many people, but the technology helped us to move further and to also see how we can stabilize these kind of simple student homes and affordable apartments. So innovation paid by the rich makes it possible to grow up in height. Next step is floating offices, where we go to 12, 14 stories. And by this, you can slowly see how we can go beyond the waterfront, how we can build buildings that are ready for that water. When I started as an architect, I always thought it was about the shape and about the building. But in every project today, we see that we're not only architects for above the water, but also underneath the water. If you bring a floating project to a location, you also have to ensure that there is no effect on the environment. So for that, we have to create underwater life, and we have to respect the nature there. So we have designed this, what we call the sea tree. And it's for a developer who wanted to have a large part in the city. And he understands that if he gives something to the city, he also can give something back. So based on the oil rig platforms from Norway, we designed a structure that has all these different kind of layers, and green will grow around it, but also underwater. It starts to be a habitat for underwater life and fish. And it was based on a story from the Mexican Gulf. In the Mexican Gulf, there were like 1,500 big oil platforms in the water. And when they were built in the 50s, people were very much against it. And they thought it would be devastating for nature, but the opposite happened. These 1,500 oil platforms, they are eco hotspots for life because you get coral around it, you get fish around it. And now after 50 years, most of them have to be decommissioned. But if you would take them away out of the Mexican Gulf, you also will take away a lot of life there. So we learn from that. How can you make structures that create underwater life? We do it in a simple scale, building the small kind of floating parks with holes in it, because you have to have light on your soil underneath it. You can grow all these kind of plants, have insects, so it's a lot of fun to do. And then, of course, on the other side, we try to get all these different kind of habitats for fish. Another project is also for Amsterdam here. It's called with floating bridges. So the city of Amsterdam needed public space, green space on the water. But of course, if you just make a park, it will take away the water. But by rising up the park and having these floating units underneath it, we can make way for the water, so still for the boats, and we can connect them to each other. So it's almost if you can constantly connect these modules to make the floating park larger or smaller, which is definitely a part of the future of the city. With that project, we gained another project, and that was in Qatar. And in Qatar, it's in summertime 40, 45 degrees. And we have there a sheikh who has this crazy idea of building a floating mangrove park of 10 kilometers by 2 kilometers. 10 kilometers by 2 kilometers. Completely full with mangroves. By that, he wants to reduce lower the temperature of the water. And he thinks there will be a kind of cool breeze from this mangroves that goes over a city. And by that, lowering the temperature in the city by 1 or 1.5 degrees. So fantastic how floating architecture and green architecture can influence the atmosphere in cities. If you want to be ready for the future, if you want to make buildings for change, if you want to be ready for any unexpected changes, we also have to build city apps. And city apps are instant solutions that can upgrade the life in cities. And it works a little bit same as the app on your phone. If you need a function, you will bring an app on your phone and you use the app sometime, and when it's not needed, you take it away. It's the same with the city. The same city has the water. We can bring a function to the city, we can use it, and afterwards we can take it away. So think about the Olympics. How crazy is it that every 4 years we build stadiums, we build hotels, we build roads, and then after 3-4 weeks they are not used anymore? So what happens if we can build floating stadiums and we can just lease them? You can lease them for 3 months or half year. Then even cities that don't have that much money still can organize these kind of events, and you can bring it from city to city. Another example for a floating city app is the floating theater we are now building in Lyon. There also, the city doesn't have enough space for new theaters in the city, doesn't have enough money to build theaters. So now these things are leased, and they are we build them, we bring them to the city, they'll be used for 4 to 5 years, and then it will be moved to next location. We build it on land, then put it in the water. You see already the seats there in the platform. And within, I think, 2 or 3 months, we will put it at this location in the city. Flexible functions moving to the city, that's what the future will look like. Another city app is a project we do for Suriname. In Suriname, they have big problems with politics, and they want to have a new kind of icon. They want to attract new tourism to the country. So they're thinking of having a kind of cruise terminal, which is a floating harbor, where cruise ships can moor. In the terminal itself, there's a conference center, there's a big shopping mall, there is a hotel rooms in it. So having kind of a fantastic, iconic, economic icon in the city. And the good thing is that investors investing in this project, if it doesn't work at this location, you can bring it to another city. And I think it's the flexibility of these kind of projects that will provide new opportunities. Again, we don't have to stop at canals. We also can go into the sea, because the sea is the limit. And there was this nice client, Ocean Builders, who had this project in Thailand. They were free spirits and said, let's build a floating house in the middle of the ocean, international water, no rules, no tax, nothing. And we can just build an own society over there. Of course, they were from the crypto industry. They had a lot of money. So they built it. And then the Navy, because it was in front of Thailand, the Navy shot them away because they didn't like them, although they were international waters. So they came to us and they asked me, Koen, can you design us a new structure that looks much more friendly? And they had a deal with the government in Panama. So they now can build this, what you called these kind of sea pods in Canada. The beauty about these kind of clients is that they push innovation. With them, we can see how we can stabilize them. We can see how we can make underwater rooms. We can see how we produce these kind of structures. This is the first one that's now almost ready. We had to make the molds. We had to see how we can place it on the platforms. So it was step by step, really a learning process. The idea is that it will be ready somewhere in August. And here you can see the platform and the structure that will be placed on top of it. And then food will be delivered with drones, and they have a fantastic, here you see the platform on top of it connected. In the future, they will build factories on the water where you can just assemble them on the water. But also this kind of spaceship kind of transport that are connecting to these things. And we need these kind of clients, because if you want to create a floating city, you need innovation, and innovation is expensive. So we're very happy that those people are willing to change the world a bit with that. Again, cities are, sea is very dangerous. And the North Sea, sometimes you see these images of these almost fantastic resorts on the ocean. That's not going to happen. It's only happening if you can ride the waves, if you can be in a safe zone. So on the North Sea, if you want to build there, it has to be almost like these kind of fortresses. For the European, we did a study to show how these kind of cities would look like. And of course, they are fortresses with a nice space inside. But from the outside, it will be very harsh metal platforms with canals in between. So building on sea, it's possible, but not everywhere. And also we have to be careful for the safety. Of course, with you in the insurance, you know that if you can't insure it, you also can't build it. But having said that, we have the technology, we have the ideas. So we are ready for the next step, which is the rise of the blue city, expansion of cities over water. I got a journalist and he asked me, Koen, how does this floating city look like? It will be spectacular. And I told him, I have to disappoint you, because it doesn't look that different than a normal city. We foresee cities just expanding over water with the same kind of fabric, floating platforms with canals in between, slowly expanding and growing, taking care of the coral and the nature around it. But in the end, it will just be a normal city, only built on the water. The first place where we really are going to do this is in the Maldives. Maldives is a very fascinating country. Well, it's 1,100 islands spread over 700 kilometers, and they are threatened by sea level rise mainly. 80% of the whole country is not higher than 1 meter above sea level. Now, if we have 1 meter or 2 meter sea level rise, the country will be gone. So 10 years ago, the president of the Maldives, they came to us, to the Dutch, to see if we can help them to change their mindset from flee to flow, to see if they can use the technology to not be climate refugees, but be climate innovators. And if you live in this country, and if you live in this main city, where there are 200,000 people living on 2 by 1 kilometer, you understand that housing is the biggest problem. So instead of just bringing sand into the water and reclaim land, what they already did, but that is not lasting, because you can make a sand island, but still if you have 2 meters of water, then also that island will be flushed away. You see the results of the tsunami in 2004, which brought a lot of sand back in the water. Then you know that you have to do something different. So for the Maldives, we are have designed in the last 5 years a floating city, and the government asked us to do it in a way that is similar to the normal culture over there. So it must be colorful houses, it must be sandy roads, it must be respect for coral. For me, quite difficult. We built normally this kind of modern buildings. So now we had to set the architecture way and try to find something how we can cope with nature locally. So we designed a structure almost like Lego. So we make blocks with 10 houses. We have this kind of connection points. And just as a child, you can start to put all these platforms together. By that, we create 17 kilometers of floating roads, ending up in a kind of city with 5,000 units. The first block of houses is ready in 4 weeks, will be installed at the end of July, and will be opened in August. And then in the next year, it will be 800 houses, then another 1,000, and then moving up to 5,000 houses in 2027. For us, this is a major step, because if you can build on water, if you can create an environment that is for people that they don't even see that it's floating, but that they have the possibility to expand and to be safe in these extreme environments, then everything is possible. Here you see some images, sandy roads. If you would look underneath these roads, you will see all these tubes and electricity and sewage plants in it. But together to create an environment that is friendly and now taking advantage of the space that they have around it. Not only just single family houses, also floating apartment buildings. They will start around $150,000, which maybe it sounds a lot, but for the Maldives is quite an affordable price. Many families live with 3 generations in one apartment, so they're happy to go to these new kind of solutions, which are only 5 minutes by boat ride from the capital city. Okay. With this kind of technology, we think we go to the next step, which we call float. And float for us is flexible land on aquatic territory. And we hope that the whole insurance industry will help us to insure it, because then the future will be very blue. Thank you.